Invisible.
Yes, Neeti, you're audible and visible.
Should I start?
Yeah, now we can see you. Yes.
Should I start, sir?
Yes, yes.
Yes, we can start. We can start now. It's 4:30, so we can start now.
Good evening to one and all present here. I am Neeti Chikle, sponsorship co-head of BMASA, your host for today's session. I would welcome you all again to a series of workshop and webinar that is BMASI sponsored certification course in medical devices, manufacturing and regulation organized by Biomedical Engineering Department of VIT. After the phenomenal success of our first three events, we are all set for yet another remarkable event where we get the opportunity to learn and expand our knowledge. On behalf of BMASI and BMASA VIT, I take this opportunity to welcome you all for the fourth event, that is Medical Device Safety by Nilesh Shinde sir. Before I go ahead, here are a few instructions to all the participants. Please keep your mics on mute and also requesting you all to note down your queries in the chat box or WhatsApp group. We will be addressing them at the end of the session. Now, I would like to give a brief introduction of our eminent guest speaker, Mr. Nilesh Shinde. Mr. Nilesh Shinde, sir, is an expertise in execution of various greenfield or brownfield projects in predefined time schedule. He successfully completed greenfield project with respect to designing and commissioning of entire services and biomedical technology of 350-bedded Jupiter Hospital, Pune in stipulated time. This project has been certified by Indo-Swiss Building Energy Efficiency Project, BEEP, for energy efficient project. He successfully commissioned 300-bedded tertiary care Vishesh Jupiter Hospital, Indore, headed the project of Neuro Rehabilitation Center, one of the state-of-art facilities in Southeast Asia, headed the project of replacement of old Siemens and installation of new GE CAT lab, which created benchmark in healthcare industry across South Asia for fastest replacement, and headed the project of installation of new robotic radio operation theater in span of 7.5 days, which has become fastest installation across India. Specialized in procurement of asset in healthcare industry, planning and commissioning of biomedical equipments, he gives his guidance to biomedical students of various colleges in Mumbai region without any financial bonding. Sir is biomedical engineering graduate from MGM College of Engineering and Technology and now CTO, Chief Technical Officer at Jupiter Hospital Group. His specialty is of execution of timely managed new projects for Jupiter Group as well as Chief Biomedical Engineering and General Engineering and maintenance of Thane Pune hospitals. His work experience is of 24 years and counting. He also worked as Chief Biomedical Engineer and Project Coordinator, Corporate General Manager Projects, Procurement and Technical Operations at Jupiter Hospital Group, and as Customer Service Support at GE Healthcare and Marketing Engineer at Larsen & Toubro Limited. During the COVID-19 pandemic, he actively participated in planning and execution of 116-bedded COVID patients facility at Seven Hills Marul Hospital in March-April 2020, as well as planning and execution of FASTES and first of its kind 1,104-bedded field BKC COVID hospitals. He received an award from Thane Municipal Corporation's Commissioner for his support and cooperation to execute 1,024-bedded Thane COVID hospital in record time of 3 weeks. He has also published guest column Take on Financial Budget and his editorial contribution on emerging trend in Indian healthcare industry. And the achievement goes on. Now I would request Geeta ma'am to welcome our speaker.
Hello, I am audible now.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, sir. After a remarkable achievement and such a big introduction, I don't know how to welcome you here. And we are really grateful that you are here in our platform to give knowledge, to impart knowledge to our students. And we are really grateful that you have agreed to conduct this session and that too without any financial backing or anything. You are instrumental in having MOU of VIT with Jupiter Group also. So you have provided many internship to our students, and even the job offers also you have given. So we are really thankful to you, and we welcome you to this platform. And we are all are eager to hear from you. So I don't want to extend my words. Welcome, sir. Welcome.
Thank you, Neeti. Thank you, Geeta madam. And I'd like to tell you that am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
So I'm associated, I believe, from 2011 with the VIT.
Yes.
And maybe in initial stage, I came to VIT to deliver some lecture on the visionary role of biomedical engineer in a healthcare industry. And today, I will discuss about something about the important part of this medical industry that is called as hospital medical equipment safety. Are you able to see my presentation?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'll move ahead. So, okay. Now I'm a CTO of this group, but 24 years back, I passed out from MBM college, and I'm also like biomedical engineer by profession. And there is absolute passion in between to me to whatever learning I've done in last 24-25 years, I would like to impart to my colleagues. And I want more people to come to biomedical field, and there is nothing impossible. I'm telling you, there is nothing impossible for biomedical engineer. Okay, so moving ahead, when I'm saying medical device, so medical device safety and effectiveness play a critical role in healthcare. Poor monitoring and management may lead to not only the inefficiency of the product, but it can also seriously harm patient outcome or operator. Now, when it comes to equipment safety or medical device safety, who is responsible for that? Who is the stakeholder? So stakeholders is not only biomedical engineers or the people who are using this machine, like technicians. It is nurses and clinicians who are also equally responsible for the equipment safety, as well as housekeeping, who normally do the job of disinfection of medical equipment. Okay, so all are the stakeholders for doing equipment safety. Now moving ahead, let us understand, when we say that factors which are mainly responsible for medical equipment safety. Now when we are saying medical equipment safety, the safety checks during pre-installation of medical equipment is very, very important. Okay. Now when I'm saying that, this is a learning curve for me also. When I started biomedical profession, we were under impression that we have to just take care of the medical equipment, but it is not so. As a biomedical engineer, we should have sufficient, or I can say sufficient knowledge about electrical field, as well as IT. In a sense, networking. So what is important is that if some medical equipment comes to you, what are things are important that before we install any medical equipment, we need to verify what are the input voltages. The reason I am telling you, there are certain equipments are running on 115 volt, and in India we run on 230 volt. So there is always a switch there. So as a first step, you have to always make sure that if you are running on 230 volt, then you have to toggle that 115 to 230. If we do not do that, then there is always a safety issue will arise. So So please make sure, first thing, verifying input voltage. Selection of appropriate line voltage during installation. The third, earthing, which is very, very important in medical equipment. Like there are 3-4 things are very, very important in medical equipment while we are doing pre-installation. So temperature, humidity, earthing, electrical supply, whether it's single phase supply or 3-phase supply. We need to look into that. Then when we say ICU or OT area, there are a lot of medical equipments are connected to the patients. So sufficient number of electrical points should be there. Now, if those are not there, in maybe due course of time, you will understand what the issue can happen because of if those points are not there in equipment safety. Now, when we say equipment maintenance, there are three types: planned maintenance, proactive maintenance, electrical safety maintenance. So what are the essential checks by maintenance team? One thing is very clear, as a biomedical, any equipment, the electrical supply is always come from either from UPS or raw power. So for ICU, we are having ELCB. So that ELCB testing has to be done by maintenance team. Thermography is very, very important, because if there is some loose connection, we can able to make out with thermography. Then testing of resources like medical gases and RO water. Then equipment disinfection, alarm management, and training. Okay, so moving ahead, what are the safety checks what we need to do during pre-installation of medical equipment? Whenever we go or whenever new equipment come in hospital, first thing we need to make sure that place or the space where we have to install the equipment has to be ready from safety point of view. So what are those safety checks? So important is that we should know as a biomedical engineer how to check neutral to earth volt. That is very, very important, because most of the times, if earth is open or neutral is not properly connected to that socket, then your neutral to earth volt will definitely be on higher side. And that is sometimes called as stray voltage. A stray voltage occurs when electricity leaks from phase directly to neutral or ground wires before passing through the device to be powered. So direct contact between neutral and phase wire should short the system and would short the system and blow fuse or circuit breaker. So please make note of that. So always neutral to earth, we need to check it, because we always tend to say phase to neutral or phase to earth, but sometimes we miss to check neutral to earth. So it is very, very important to check that before we install any equipment. So moving ahead, so now you can see that if I want to connect phase to earth, this is just a pictorial way. It is not like everywhere it is possible. So you can see that phase to earth is 240 volt. This is a multimeter what we use. Normally the multimeter what we use should be calibrated properly. And when we do calibration from third party, we should have a good traceability report for that, because that is very, very important when we are doing any calibration. So here you can see phase to neutral is 237 volt, where neutral to earth 3.1. Anything above 5 volt in neutral to earth is not safe for medical equipments. Please make note of that. Now here you can see that what we discuss, and you can see that there is a setting of 115 and 230 volt. This is a monitor. Okay, so these are the monitor which are used in ICU. This is setting for 115 volt and 230 volt. So before you put what normally happens that if normally if you do not see this and directly on 115 volt setting is there, and if you connect to our single phase supply, then definitely the power supply will get damaged, and it can also create a damage to the system or damage to the person who is operator. So please make sure that whenever you are switching on, the basic thing, first thing, please see the voltages. This is now we always say that earthing is very, very important. If you see that all the medical equipments like CT, MRI, cath lab, PET CT, nuclear medicine, LINAC, everyone, all the vendor will ask for dedicated earthing. So earthing is very, very important, because if you do not have proper earthing, then there is no way the leakage current will pass to the earth. And if it doesn't pass to the earth, then if the earthing is not proper, then it will flow either to the patient operator or through the system. So earthing has to be proper, dedicated for the medical equipment. So what are the guidelines for earth pit? There are two ways you can do the earthing. So one is pipe, typically pipe type earthing station. So like these are GI pipes, CI pipes which are there. Now you, here you can see that like 100 is internal diameter. And if you see that 3 meter below the earth it goes. Now what happens that if you do not have more space, then CI pipe what we use, this is called a pipe earthing. Now ideally pipe earthing is not suitable, because after 5 to 6 years it becomes corroded and your earthing resistance will increase. But if you do not have space available in your site, then there is no other option than going than pipe earth. So you can see here 3 meter from top to bottom, you have to go 3 meter inside the soil. Okay. And you can see here funnel. The funnel, why we use it funnel, that to pour water continuously. If the earth resistance is in, if you come across that it is increasing, then you have to do it. Now there is another method. This is normally most of the times it is used. You can see here, these are copper strip. You can see copper strip here. There are two copper strip, one single which goes out. From there we take it to respective machine. There is a GI funnel with cap. Then there is a CI cover in frame. This is now drawing which is there. Now here also, if you see that almost 3 meter we are going below the earth. Now the next thing, how it looks like physically, that is pictorial view. Now you can see here chamber. Now you can see this funnel. This is earthing plate. Can you see this earthing plate? This is a funnel. Now when it is buried inside the earth, you can say in this way, this is the funnel. From there you can pour water. This is the real picture of the earthing. Now how to measure the earth resistance? Now you can hear this audio video, you can able to see that how it happens.
Hi, ये निप्पल में एक earth tester है. ये earth tester का terminal से C1, P1, P2 and C2. C1 and P1 internally short किया हुआ है. वहाँ से एक wire हम लोग ने earth pit को दिया हुआ है. P2 as a reference, meter से 15 meter की दूरी पे हम लोग जमीन में दिया हुआ है. C2 as a second reference, हम लोग जमीन में इस साइड 15 मीटर की दूरी पे दिया हुआ है. अभी हम लोग अर्थ टेस्ट कर रहे हैं. ये अर्थ पिट का रेजिस्टेंस है 2 ओम, मतलब ये पिट का वैल्यू है 2 ओम. थैंक यू.
सो दिस इज वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. वी नीड टू कैरी आउट. दिस इज नॉट ओनली फॉर आवर ओन सेफ्टी, फॉर मेडिकल इक्विपमेंट सेफ्टी. We have to carry out this earth resistance test every year, submit the report. Now if you are having in-house this meter. You can do it at any time. If it is not there, if it is more than 3 ohms or 5 ohms, then there is a serious concern for that, for your earthing, and you need to take fast action on that earth pit to avoid any issues of leakages, current leakages, or shock to operator, or if something is flowing through the machine equipment. So to avoid that, you have to carry out this type of earth resistance on the regular manner. Now, if you see here, there are dedicated earthing has been shown. This is a requirement, which is copper strip, which is normally depends on company to company. These are the earth pits which are required, like these are LINAC, HDR machines, CT, MRI, X-ray, mammography, gamma camera, or cath lab. Now, here you can see on the right side, minimum size of copper strip which is required by vendors. Now, it can vary depending on company to company, but more or less, these are the specific requirements which are must when we are installing any equipment. So these are dedicated earthing, which like whatever you see there just now, the earthing strips, then dedicated earthing area, what we have considered. From there, we need to consider this type of copper strips, which will come up to the power supply of that medical equipment. Now, this is one thing which has we have discussed about earthing. Now, the second thing is this UPS. Now, electrical supply, either it can be raw, it can be UPS. In Mumbai, the supply quality is good. So people are still using raw supply also. But if you see that, like in, because we face in Thane, Pune, all the areas or all Thane district area, there is always a fluctuation in electrical supply. So when we are using medical equipment for that, you have to make sure that supply, whatever you get, has to be uninterrupted power supply with constant voltage and voltage. So now when we say that, most of the companies will ask for dedicated UPS for MRI, CT scan, LINAC, PET CT, as well as cath lab. But what happens to the equipment of ICU, OT, blood bank, pathology, then ER department? So for those department also, we have to run the equipments on UPS supply. And we are using UPS supply. But there are certain equipments like X-ray, or you have to carry out C-arm. Though normally there is a inrush current happens and you cannot put it on UPS. Now in our hospital, we are having 200 kVA, two number of UPS system, which is run in parallel. So now to make out between difference UPS and raw power, you can see here, this is UPS power. This is for raw is white. Now this is something in brown color plate is there. Just to make out, now this is UPS power, this is raw power. This is the easiest identification for end user, for nursing staff, for anyone. So this is what we have done across hospital. Now, this is central UPS, and this type of different equipments like this ultrasound equipment, this is ventilator, syringe pump, monitors, dialysis machines, what we use on centralized UPS. So moving ahead, this is one thing we discussed, that we should have a good earthing, then we should have a neutral to earth load, should be as less as possible. Earth resistance should be maximum 2 ohms or less than that is always preferable. These are things are okay. Now, once you are having all these things, now consider the case that critical air units like ICU, NICU, PICU, OT. When we design any ICU or NICU, PICU, OT, we realize that, now consider intensive critical care unit. See that how many electrical points are used, one per patient bed. Now all the beds are now electrical, manual beds are not being used in ICUs. So patient bed with 5 movement normally are used, patient monitor, ventilator, syringe pump, 8 to 10 syringe pumps are required, एयर मैट्रेस, प्रोट्रॉन पंप, सीआरआरटी और डायलिसिस मशीन, आईबीपी, ब्लड वार्मर, पेशेंट वार्मर, 1.4 एक्सरे यूएचजी. सो टोटल रिक्वायर्ड पॉइंट इज हाउ मच, 18 टू 20 इन वन क्यूबिकल ऑफ इंटेंसिव क्रिटिकल यूनिट. प्लीज अंडरस्टैंड दैट when we are having patient, whenever some patient comes in critical unit, we don't know what are things are required for him. Anything can be required at any moment. So we have to prepared with those electrical points. If you are not prepared with electrical points, what happens? I will show you in next slide. Now this is basically for intensive critical care units. Moving ahead, this is neonatal critical care, जो बच्चों के लिए होता है. Now, high frequency, then nitric oxide delivery system, NO system, humidifier, patient monitor, baby warmer, syringe pump, blood warmer, compressor. If you see here, around 17 points are required for this type of critical care unit of neonatal. Moving ahead, if you go to operation theater, cardiac. Now, normally we are having in any of the operation data, you can see that there are anesthesia pendant, there is a surgeon pendant, there is a wall point. Now, what are things comes on the anesthesia pendant? OT monitor, that depends. Now, this is what we are using in our hospital. It can vary by hospital to hospital depending on end user. Now, here, OT monitor, anesthesia machine, beast monitor, cell saver, syringe pumps, cautery, IBP, cell saver, heart lung machine, heater cooler unit. So there are 17 points only on anesthesia pendant. Similarly on surgeon pendant, where the surgeon operates, on that side DPIP, headlight, OT table, patient warmer, blood warmer, ACT machine. And wall points, which is the wall of the OT, there is one point per slave, the slave monitor, which is the anesthesia machine, slave monitor, water bath, or any PC. So if you see here, we are talking about almost 27 to 30 machines. Now, if you are using some robo machine, like any of the robo machine, what we use, then there is their own trolley comes there and points increases. It can go up to maybe 30 points also. Now, please understand that. Now, if you consider, this is the picture. Now, if this is the NICU. Now you can see there warmer, HFO and NO. And there are plenty of syringe pump. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. The small baby is there. Okay. Now there is a blood warmer also here. So if you see here all these things, can you see that there are a lot of equipments are there? So when this happens, a lot of equipments are there. And if you do not have a proper electrical points, then you tend to use extension boards. Can you see these extension boards? Because there is no other option, because you have to give power supply to all these gadgets. So you have to use extension board. So someone will say, what is wrong in extension board? What is wrong that you can always give the power supply through extension board? But please consider here the fact, all these are syringe pumps are there. So these syringes are filled with some saline, some injections, okay, which is injected continuously to that patient. Now consider the case, you can see here the plunger, this is the syringe pump, and here is a syringe, whatever we use there, and from here there is a tubing there, which will connect to the patient. Now consider the case, while operating all these things, if there is some leakage there of this, and if this droplet fall down on this electrical extension board, what will happen? It will make sure that that equipment entire area will get tripped, but if it neutral and face or earth, if we can short to each other, there is chance of fire safety. So when it fire happens, consider the case when this small kid is lying here and if something goes wrong here, how to tackle that scenario? So is it a safe environment? It is not at all safe. These are all the medical equipments are there. Patient is here. This is not safe environment at all. So while planning, you have to make sure that there should not be clutter of extension board. Okay, we'll move ahead. Can you see here? Now, these are ICU. You can see how many are there, syringe pump, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 3, 10. Then all these points are there. So there are more than 20 are there, and then extension board has been used. And while when they are there in ICU, there is really less time available with them. They have to do a lot of bedside procedure. They cannot wait or just to see that whether any water droplets are going there down or not, because that is life and death. That type of emergency is there, and that has been tackled by the clinician, nurses, and everyone. So while doing that, if there is no sufficient points in that room, you tend to use extension board. And if you use extension board, there are chances of short circuit, fire, entire area can get tripped. So, and you can see that a lot of clutter of wires which happens, and if that short happens, it becomes very difficult to isolate that also during running hospital when patient is there already. There is a lot of pressure on maintenance team to isolate that and start the supply again. So it is better your supply should not get tripped, and for that either you can use this type of multi-output power cord. You can see here, instead of 5 different electrical sockets, it has connected in such a way, this is a specially made, we can connect only one cable or one cable to the socket, and with one electrical power supply you can able to take care of all 5 syringe pump. Here you can see a different model with 6 pump stacker. What happens, instead of these 6 different cables, you can able to use, or 6 sockets has been used, instead of you can use, get rid of all these things, and we can use only one which will take care of all these things. Moving ahead, this is one more option of 5 pump stacker. This is option of 3 pump stacker. So I am not promoting here stacker. Here the idea is that either you should have a sufficient electrical points, like more points in your ICU while you are planning, then you don't have to use anything. You can connect directly to electrical points. But if you do not have it and still you have to run the show and take care of ICU or NICU, so the only option is that use stacker so that you can get rid of all these extension boards. Okay, we will move ahead. Now, can you see this? This is typical ICU cubicle. This is the bed, what you use the ICU. These are the electrical points on both sides. These are the rods. Okay, one is for equipment pole, one is IV pole. So normally, IV pole has to get connected here, and equipment pole, on that equipment pole, all syringe pump needs to get attached here. But what happens sometimes, that is biomedical also plays a role into that. You need to give training continuously, vigorously to end user. They should not put these syringe pumps here, because if they put it here, there are chances that there can be saline leak from this IV pole and it can enter into the syringe pump. And if it is enter into syringe pump, and if there is some short happens, your power supply of that cubicle is going to short. There are chances because of that fire can also happen. To avoid all these things, you have to make sure you have to give continuous training to end user how to use IV pole, how to use equipment pole. This is typical ICU cubicle. Moving ahead, as I said, these are syringe pump. You can see here this syringe pump, where is a normal what we use for our CPU anywhere system, just the socket which will go, cable which goes there. So what changes we have done? This is the international change has been done after our inputs to that company. This company called model is Grasby. Smith Medical is a company. They have made changes like this. What is happening because that now the cable is going inside. So even if there is a drip of saline, it does not go inside. And our short circuit cause has gone down drastically after doing this small change. You can see it here. By doing this small socket, that problem has resolved. So all these small modification you need to do as a biomedical engineer, suggest to companies so that they can able to implement, because now this implementation has not happened here in India. It has happened at their factory. So that depends on, now as I told you, biomedical engineer can do. Now we are not maybe designer of this, but this type of suggestion we can give, because that the changes company can do it at their level, because this is safety not only for our hospital, for our patient, for everyone who are going to use this type of product. Okay, moving ahead, equipment maintenance. Now equipment maintenance, what we knew normally biomedical engineer does at hospital level, I'm talking about that equipment maintenance. So there are two type of equipment maintenance. One is proactive maintenance, one is planned maintenance. Okay, so we will first go to planned maintenance. So what is meaning of planned maintenance? When we procure, like when we procure any equipment, we make sure that what is the warranty of that equipment, what is the life cycle cost of that equipment for next 10 years. Okay, then what will happen in AMC or CMC during planned maintenance, what we say PMS, what are the services company is going to carry out, what is the frequency of that, that everything has to be defined in your purchase order. So if you get chance to work in any of the hospital or any of the industry or any, then you have to capture all those things very clearly, that what are things that are going to happen in planned maintenance. Now when I'm saying planned maintenance, preventive maintenance is something like that, that is defined by the manufacturer, that we have to do preventive maintenance of the machine yearly or quarterly or after completion of so many hours. So this is always a defined time which is given by the manufacturer. So that is called as preventive maintenance. Then calibration is a process, very, very important, that compares a standard against unknown, the customer device. All measuring equipment like volume, pressure, weight, speed will require a calibration, like syringe pump, BB apparatus, suction machine has to do the proper calibration, including weighing machine also. Please understand that when we are having a patient for cancer treatment, when we do chemotherapy, on their weight, the consultant decide what type of medication has to be given to that patient. Now this calibration of weighing scale also makes a difference. Please understand very clearly. Now someone will say that my weight is 78 kg and if I'm weighing machine is showing 80 kg, what makes a difference? Or if it is 79 kg, what makes a difference? But it is not so in medical equipment. Okay, it makes a difference because their doses are dependent on the weight calculation, body weight calculation. Similarly, pressure, when we see speed, all these things has to be calibrated, and that calibration process has to be defined, and company defines that calibration, when it has to be done. It has to be done through, first through company, then through third party. So calibration, then similarly validation, like HEPA filter, lamina flows, sterilizers, for that we have to conduct validation, that is conducted once in a year. Now quality assurance. All radiology equipment, if you see that, if you go to AERB website also, you can able to see that quality assurance is very, very important. Nowadays the new rule has come that quality assurance is need to be conducted once in 2 years. But if you are replace any X-ray related product, or which is X-ray generating product in that equipment, then you need to carry out QA immediately and inform to AERB. So these are things are like planned maintenance. Ye karna hi hai. Okay, so now when I'm saying preventive maintenance, like this is example of McAfee ventilator. You can see here, every year we have to replace their air O2 filter, bacteria filter, nozzle units, bacteria filter by inspiratory transducer. All these things we have to do mandatory if you want to do maintain the safety of the equipment. Some of the hospitals, some of the places, it is not been done. So it depends on individual to individual. If you are considering patient is your first priority and their safety is the first priority, the staff is operator safety is the first priority, then you have to do preventive maintenance and frequency as per the schedule given by the company. So moving ahead, now here you can see the calibration of syringe pump. Please listen to this audio video. This type of calibration is done through vernier caliper. So you might have understood that now this plunger, because syringe pump, when it is used, the plunger pushes that syringe and when it moves ahead, there is a test there with calibration, vernier caliper, they test. And a particular distance, if it covers, then calibration test is linear accuracy test is passed. So this is what is done for syringe pump. Now these are the validation, what we do, steam sterilizer, there is a temperature. Because steam sterilizer work on 134 degrees centigrade, 121 degrees centigrade. Now, whatever we say, whatever we can see, 134 or 121, whether really it happens or not. Now, someone has to validate that. Now, validation, who can able to do the validation? There are companies, NABL accredited companies, the third party companies who does all these activity like temperature, pressure validation for sterilizer. Now, laminar flow, what we use for YSFT cabinet as well as OT, we need to do the validation for that. During HEPA filter validation, now there are HEPA filters what we use in operation theaters. Okay, then we need to understand that whether it is that HEPA filter, whatever is there, it is doing its work or not. Whether it is giving the proper supply or not, means air supply. Whether there is any leak or not, that is possible with the help of validation, what we carry out across as per the norms given by NABH or JCI. Now moving ahead, now this is also important. When we say defibrillator, we have to check with defib analyzer. Now when we are saying, please understand, like if you see that, whenever we are selecting something, we are giving on patient chest, we are putting these paddles and we are giving the shock to him. So we are passing energy through that. Now, when we are passing energy, it should not happen that if I'm selecting something, if you see here, the selected energy is 0 to 5, 3, 0 to 6. So it is like energy delivered into 50 ohms, how much it is delivered. We have to see, and there is a plus to minus 15% tolerance is there. We need to consider that for everything you can see here. For all the energy, we need to see that regular basis with the help of diffusive analyzer. This is very, very important from the safety point of view, because we are going to directly give that current or shock to the patient. So that has to be properly done. Now, which are the equipments which need calibration? So cautery, nitric oxide, tourniquet, pacemaker, baby warmer, ACT machine, cup gauge, centrifuge, coagulation analyzer, hematology, lab incubator, lab oven, dialysis machine, laser, syringe pump, infusion pump, hotline blood warmer, PCA pump, breath test analyzer, pocket dosimeter, portable suction machine, proton, air mattress, multimeter, vaporizer, weighing module, all the weighing machine requires a calibration. Now, we know that when we use patient in ICU or maybe ward, patient is there for long time. So there is specific to avoid any beds, or we have to use air mattress. Now, air mattress what we use has to be also calibrated. We cannot use anything which is not calibrated. So like this is the product what we use in our hospital, Arjo, where you can see here the pressure range minimum is 23 mmHg, pressure range maximum 70. So when we do this, tolerance is plus minus 5. So when we do this, we get all these readings. This is calibrated or maybe tested, this master equipment used for calibration. So there is a traceability has been given for that. So this is very, very important to do have a calibration certificate. Now, these are the equipments which requires QA. So fixed X-ray, portable X-ray, C-arm, tomography, cath lab, PET-CT, CT, dental X-ray, OPG, BMD. These are the things which require validation, steam sterilizer, LTSF sterilizer, biosafety cabinet, plasma, lamina flow, OTFA filters. Now, whatever we discuss is a plan activity, PMS. But PMS is something like that. Company has said that this has to happen in maybe 3 months, 6 months, something like that. But what is important? Where the biomedical engineer plays important role? The biomedical plays important role if they are doing proactive checks. Friends, I would like to tell you that biomedical engineer can do any magic. There is nothing impossible. Only thing we will have to change our mindset that we can do everything. Now, if you do really proactive checks properly in hospital, if you are having a basic knowledge about electricity, or maybe at least if you know how to check phase neutral, neutral to earth, and how to check earth resistance, and if you know connectivity, network connectivity, how to load the software Windows or MS Office, then you are really a good biomedical engineer. Believe me, experience will come. Today you are there in college, you may not have work on most of the equipments, but what you can do, which I will always like to tell, that maybe connect two pieces, try to connect two or three pieces through hub or through switch. Networking, you can do it. You can load software Windows, get yourself trained on that, how to load Windows, how to, once you can load it, then you can remove that, try to load Microsoft Office, try to load Linux software. These are the things are very, very important. If you do that, you will get more confidence when you will come on field. Now, similarly, this is what we are following in our hospital, and as a biomedical is a passion for me. So I always thought that biomedical engineer should not be the place, or office should not be a place like a customer care, or what we say that now call center, that some department has given a call to you and you are transferring that call to other other companies, and let them come, let them solve your issues, and you are through with that. We should not do in that way. In our hospital, 87% of calls are been handled and resolved by in-house biomedical team. So this is very, very important. How much you can do in-house? If you give confidence, don't worry. Today is an era Now you know that during COVID, no one can physically come also. That time you cannot say machine is down, and because engineer is not there, we can't do anything. We have to do it as a biomedical engineer, because then that will give a confidence to the management that biomedical engineer is an asset. Not asset only during COVID, but they are there throughout the life cycle of the hospital industry. That biomedical engineer is an asset. But we have to work in that way. We have to prove that, yes, it is possible. And that is possible if we do proactive checks. क्या है मालूम है क्या, जैसा कुछ भी मशीन को प्रॉब्लम आने के पहले इफ यू एबल टू गिव द सॉल्यूशन फॉर दैट एवरीवन विल बी हैप्पी. नाउ ऑल दिस मेडिकल इक्विपमेंट्स लाइक फॉर एनी ह्यूमन बीइंग व्हेनेवर ही गोज टू डॉक्टर देयर आर सम सिम्टम्स आर ऑलरेडी देयर एंड ही इज अवेयर अबाउट दैट. दैट पेशेंट इज अवेयर. समटाइम्स ही निगलेक्ट, समटाइम्स ही एक्सप्लेन टू द डॉक्टर. सिमिलरली फॉर मेडिकल इक्विपमेंट फ्रॉम द सेफ्टी पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू, if you, there are a lot of checks are there, that will always be there. Only thing, how much we are keen to understand our equipment, like the way consultant understand the patient, similarly the way biomedical engineer has to understand our own machines. And it is possible, and if you do that, if you properly monitor that, lot of damages and safety of the equipment you can able to take it. Now what is, when I'm saying that, what are things? The daily, weekly checklist. Now ensuring all the equipments are in UPS and batteries are charged to maximum. Please understand very, very clearly what happens normally. Now we are having a equipment, UPS is there. Equipments also are having UPS and batteries, but people do not, they put the socket, they connect that our cable to that socket, but do not switch on that plug. They feel that UPS is running, batteries are charging, but whenever power goes, that time battery is totally discharged. So you have to make sure that all your equipments are on UPS and the supply for that, the power plug is on. Air filter cleaning for all ventilators, that is a life saving for dialysis machine also. Monitoring of temperature of refrigerator, deep freezer, lab, oven, autoclave. This is all, these things are there, blood bank, pathology. You need to monitor temperature. If you do not monitor the temperature, if it goes, there are certain things which are like 2 to 8 degrees. Some are there minus 20, some are there minus 40, minus 37, minus 80 degrees. So for deep freezer. So if you do not monitor those temperature, there are chances that something, if you neglect that, then there are chances that something can happen and you will land up in a scenario of safety. So please take care of all these things, monitoring of temperature. Then cleaning of filters, of chiller is very, very important. Then one more thing you need to check in your daily checklist. Now we are talking about IT era. Lot of things are shared on your hard disk. Okay, now MRI, CT scan, earlier when I started my career, the CT scan was 2-slice CT scan. Now it has gone up to 760. So it's a huge number, huge difference. One patient is having around 700, 800 images. Now those are getting stored on hard disk. Then if you are having 25 patient per day, you can imagine how much space has been considered in hard disk. Now you have to always see that. Now if you simply see in any of the computer system also, that if you are running, your hard disk is full, and if you are running on 90%, your performance is not up to the mark. And it can get crash. Similar thing is there here also. In medical equipment also, console is there. There are servers are there. So if you move ahead and if the hard disk capacity increases, then there are chances that system can get crash and you can lose the data. So you have to check, you have to inform, you have to give training to the end user to remove that or take a backup of all this or push it on packs so that they will able to get the retrieval of the images at any moment. Now here you can see, can you see here, there are clock fan filter in old ventilator. So these are block fan filters can cause internal heating on, because why the filters has been given fan filter? To make sure that the temperature inside will not increase and air will circulate throughout the equipment. If that is clogged, what happens? there will be a lot of internal heating in the equipment and result in or breakage of or unexpected breakdown during ventilation. And when you are saying breakage in ventilation, that means the patient, because ventilator, when it will get used, when it is there on the patient. So any unexpected breakdown of ventilation, that means a real nightmare for biomedical engineer who is working there. So to avoid all these things, make sure that you clean it properly on regular basis so that you can avoid this type of unexpected breakdown. Now, these are the chillers. These are for the MRI chillers. If you do not clean it properly, this filter cleaning, then again clog will happen. The chiller can stop. If chiller is not working, it will eventually increase the temperature inside MRI equipment room and it will stop working, functioning. So UPS battery rack, can you see there something is kept on the UPS? This is not allowed. You have to keep everything empty. Now UPS battery rack, if you see any of the battery of UPS, it has been mentioned very clearly that it runs well on 25 degrees centigrade. But most of the places or most of the hospitals, this area is always neglected. UPS battery, usme kya itna temperature, why to waste energy there? And they make that area, temperature goes up to 30, 32 degrees, 35 degrees. That is source of fire, because if that battery temperature inside, if it get break, then it is difficult to control and there is a fire alarm or fire system will get activated. If that happens, if fire occurs, then system will get activated. So if you see here, like these are the freezer, deep freezer, so you need to see that thermograph, temperature controller, whether set temperature and actual temperature is same or not, that you can do temperature monitoring continuously and able to do that. Now here, O2 cylinder placement during transport. Can you see here one cylinder? Now this is not the ideal way of keeping the cylinder, because if this bed comes down during transport, you will get stuck up. Your patient will get stuck up. The ideal is that outside the bed. Now this is coming. If you want to go down now, in this case, go down, you are going to hit on this. And during transport, this is not an ideal one. So this is the ideal one to keep it in this way. Now this is CT scan. Okay, now you know that when I'm saying the CT scan, it has gone slip ring technology. So whenever slip ring technology, there are chances that CT scan is like always considered emergency services. Personally, I have installed around more than 80 CT scan in my during course of time in GE. And my experience that there are a lot of spillage happens. So to avoid that spillage in our hospital, we put this type of, you can see that a polythene bag is there, a big bag is there, which avoids, even if it is like most of accident cases, we do CT scan in emergency. When bleeding, a patient is having bleed, then if it goes inside this slip ring, then it is going to create a problem and machine will be down. Image quality will be having some issue. To avoid all these things, small thing you can do it, just put this and you are taken care of that issue. So small thing, biomedical engineer has to do it, take care of safety of your own equipment. Now here you can see that this is cath lab. Now this cath lab C arm move. Now this is the area we can mark here. That depends on individual to individual. This we have done in our Indore hospital, just to make sure that your C-arm will not come or any equipment will not come inside this area, so that whenever C-arm will move in this direction, none of the equipment will come in this strip of area which has been marked on the ground. So this is one of the marking of gantry rotation area, which will give the idea to everyone, we should not bring it any equipment there. Now when we do use a drills, excessive use of burrs in case of drills, what happens that normally, if you know that in orthopedic we use saw, drill. Now in case of drill, if you are using burrs and if you are using reusing the continuous burrs, okay, what happens because of that, because of reuse of burrs, your drill will get damaged. So power tool is drill, the the force from where it comes, it will lose his power, and the power two will not able to perform properly if you are reusing the burrs. So please make sure excessive use of burrs are not important, or you should avoid that for safety of your equipment. Now here you can see that ventilator. If you keep something like this on ventilator, the incidents like this spillage can happen. Please understand, you can see here spillage has happened and this board has got damage. Now what is the cost for that? Huge cost is there, because this will not get covered in your CMC contract also, because this is not CMC contract or warranty covers only manufacturing defect, not like this with a manual intervention or someone has mishandled this machine, and because that this has happened. So this spillage has happened only because of all these things. So avoid doing that. This is very, very important. Now you can see that this UHG machine, when we use, we have to use a UPS supply, but sometimes in UPS supply also we get an interference because of some neutral earth, some interference happens. To avoid that, we have to use ferrite core. You can see here, and if you use ferrite core, you can tackle the issues like interference. Now, as I said, that safeguarding of patient data, which already I told you, either you can take a backup, put it on packs. Now, you can see here capacity. Now, if you say capacity 400, use is 360. This is not ideal. This is now 10% is remaining. This is not the ideal scenario. And if you are happening in this way, your speed of the machine will go down. And at the same time, there are chances that if the data, the software crash, and if this data goes, and if you do not have backup, you will not able to retrieve the data back. Now, this is electrical safety checks, what we normally do. So this is what happens at 1 milliampere sensitivity, let go current 10 milliamp, 100 milliamp to 100 ampere is a muscle contraction, suffocation, all these things happen. So these are the effect of if electrical current pass to our body. So electrical safety means limiting the hazard of electrical macro or micro shocks sustained by patient, as well as explosion, fire, damage to equipment and operator. Electrical shocks, macro are caused due to equipment failure or failure power delivery system, ground failure. To avoid such hazard, the necessary to conduct electrical safety tests on the regular interval. Now these are the electrical safety tests which are there. With the visual inspection, measurement of ground wire resistance, measurement on chassis, that you need to do it, electrical safety test from third party, or disturbed electrical safety analyzer has been used, anti-static grease trap has been used, anti-static mat normally we use. Now these are the ESA test report, you can see here. So here there are electrical safety, there is something visual test, this is functional test. This is third party NABL accredited lab. They can able to do this calibration for electrical safety. Now, please see, as I told you that internal resistance of UPS battery is also important, because we are using a lot of UPS and batteries in medical equipment. So you should know how to do that. I will show you audio video for that, internal, how to check the internal resistance test of UPS batteries.
So basically, charging voltage is 13.5 to 13.6. Voltage is normal. And higher value is not more than 5 milliohms. The normal range is 0 to 5 milliohms. Battery is normal voltage.
Okay, so now what point I want to mention here is that now, as a biomedical engineer, you will come across a lot of equipments with UPS and batteries. The battery vendor will always come to you and they will say, after 2.5 years, replace the battery, replace the battery. Now, replacing battery is not a small amount. Please understand that. Now, as a biomedical, why I showed this video to you is basically that as a biomedical engineer, you should able to ask that vendor, shows the your internal resistance. If it is internal resistance is less than 5 milliohm, nothing is going to happen for your battery if you are maintaining 25 degree and if your voltage is around 13 volt, nothing is going to happen to your battery. Please believe me. And we are using maintain our atmosphere or temperature in such a way that the temperature is around 25 degree and we are using these UPS batteries for 5 years, 6 years also. Because replacing 64 batteries or 128 batteries of 120H or 150H or 200H costs in the range of 10 lakhs. But if you do, this is what is the importance of biomedical engineering. If they really think in that way, what are things are important? Is it only 2 years is the life of the battery? It is not so. If you maintain temperature properly, if you maintain the voltage, if you see that disturbed voltage, if you see, and if you see internal resistance, you can able to take the call, you can talk to them, because this is what is mentioned very clearly by all the companies. So they cannot challenge you if you are thorough with your own knowledge. Okay, and we are using it from years together. That is the reason I show you this video to you. Now, these are the essential check by maintenance team need to be done. Now, this is very, very important. If you see that ICU, we say that earth leakage hua to immediately trip hona chahiye. Okay, now how it happens? Someone has to check. I'm having ELCP whether it's working or not working. Now someone has to check that. Now this is what the checking what we do in our hospital. You can this listen
now
to this.
We are checking on load RCCP, which is of 30 milliampere and which is on live circuit. Now this is the ELCP tester we have connected. Now we will trip this RCCP on load for a particular milliampere current, and we will see which milliampere it is tripping and which millisecond timing it is tripping. So we will check both ampere tripping, milliampere tripping, as well as timing tripping. So now we'll put this test button. So it has started giving leakage current inside. It has tripped for 27 milliampere. So first test is over. Now we will switch it to timing setting by which we will check the timing of the tripping. Switch it on. Phase, neutral and earthing both are visible over here. It is circuit is live. 230 volt is the voltage that we are receiving to the circuit. Now we will test it. So we have pressed the test button and within 11 milliseconds it has tripped. So this ELCP has worked for the 30 milliampere tripping setting as it has tripped on 27 milliampere before 30 and it has tripped on 11 millisecond timing which is also below 33 millisecond. So this RCCP is working safe and it is giving the adequate protection which is required from this circuit. ELCP testing or RCT testing is over.
So I hope you understood this, how to do that. This is very, very important because it has to, we have to do this type of testing because it has to trip. If it doesn't trip, that means if there is a earth leakage is there, if it doesn't trip, then it will create huge chaos or maybe fire issue can come because of that. Short circuit can happen. To avoid all these things, ELCP testing of all the critical areas wherever ELCBs or RCCBs are there, we have to do it. This is also one thing very important maintenance team has to do, thermography. What happens if there is a loose connection? If you see here, this is a thermography unit what we use. Now if you see here, there is a 51.6 degree temperature is showing. Anything above 36, so there is something loose connection. You can see here. Now once you see that, you can see that there is something loose connection here. After refitting everything, you can see that now it has come to 36.6. So this is very, very easy tool to handle. Biomedical engineer also can do it. They can handle it and they can able to make out whether there is any loose connection. Okay. So these are, as I told you, there are medical equipment, there are testing for medical gases also, because in ventilator, we are using oxygen, in a compressed air also we are using. So testing of medical gases is important. Compressed air what we use should not have any moisture inside. So these are the tests, medical gas tests, what we need to do it. This is done as per the NABH or JCI guideline. Similarly, this is RO water test report, because RO water is very, very important what we use for a dialysis purpose. There should not be bacteria, there should not be E. coli, total viable count should be less. So this is as per the Army standard. All these things you can able to see, all these parameters are there. There are almost 32 parameters are there for this. Now coming back to that, one more important point in safety is equipment disinfection. Equipment disinfection is a process that reduces number of microorganisms to a level at which they do not present to at a risk to patient. But uses of inappropriate disinfectant may lead to equipment surface damage. It is necessary to use manufacturer recommended disinfectant approved by hospital infection control team for effective disinfection, ensuring patient safety and equipment safety both. What happens if you are not using recommended manufacturer recommended disinfectant? Okay, now if you see here, this is a baby warmer. It has been mentioned that do not use following cleaners. They will damage the parts being cleaned: isopropyl alcohol, ammonium solvent. Caution, do not spray cleaner directly on the unit. And these are the cautions which are given. If we do that, then what will happen? Can you see this? This is a bit damaged due to only and only because of improper disinfection. Cracks has been developed. Now, patient monitor, what are things disinfectant we should use? You can see here, the company is saying that, or manufacturer is saying that these are the disinfectant, we need to use it. Now, it also mentioned that if you use improper, then what is the impact or what will happen? So it will make sure they please understand. It also mentioned equipment malfunction can happen and it will void warranty. This is very, very important. It's void warranty also. It can cause issue to the patient also. So patient safety is also on toss if you are not using proper disinfectant. You can see here the cracks which has been developed. This is only because of improper disinfectant. Now, one more point is alarm. There are a lot of ICU and OT equipments are there. There are a lot of alarms has been given. Now, if you see here, this high priority alarm, medium priority alarm, high priority, there is tachycardia happens. These are monitors, the multi-parameters, and these are the red colors is high priority, medium priority, low priority, and informative alarm. What happens most of the time? In night time, whenever their in charge goes home, nursing staff or any other staff tend to switch off or these alarms or reduce the voice of these alarms. So as a biomedical engineer, whenever we are taking round, we have to make sure that this alarm should be in a proper range. It should be in audible range. If someone has reduced that, you have to make sure that you have to give training that they should not do that, because that is safety of the patient. Because it is giving some alarm, and if you are ignoring those alarm, that is, we are playing with the safety of the patient as well as the equipment. So coming back to the last thing is like training. As I told you, all users are responsible for safety of the medical equipments. If the user staff isn't thoroughly trained or lack basic understanding of using this, then there is a risk for patient and operator. Operator injury increase. Now, if I tell you that cautery, most of the OT we use cautery. If we do not use the proper pad for that, there are issue that cautery one happens. Then, as I mentioned that in lab oven or incubator, if plastic material is kept in that, the temperature will increase and it can cause a problem or burn or damage. So these are all these things are very, very important. We need to consider that during our training. And following points need to be covered during training: operation application related risk, then give awareness to the end user about the damage that can cause by fluids on machine, prevention of cautery machine, equipment damage in case of MRI. You know that MRI, what thing can go wrong. Personally, I have seen that during my earlier period of biomedical engineering in various companies. I work on MRI. I did a lot of installation of MRI. So if you are carrying any oxygen cylinder near MRI, and if you are, nowadays it is 3 Tesla MRI, it is really a fatal accident can happen. You might have seen also a couple of years back, it has happened in Mumbai also in one of the hospital. So MRI is very, very dangerous. You cannot carry anything there. So QASA you need to do properly. So training has to be continuous process, and all these things will give us a scenario where you can able to take care of patient safety, equipment safety, and we can move ahead with that. So thanks a lot. Now, if you are having any queries, if you are having any queries, we can take it. Hello, can you hear me? Hello.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Yeah. So if you are having any queries, let us know so that we can take it. I hope you could able to see my presentation. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Sir, there are some questions. Sir, okay. Why are there very less opportunities in internship for biomedical engineers? Somebody has asked.
Okay. So, Vidhi, a good question. Why there is very less opportunities? Yes, I understand that. Nowadays, when I did my engineering, that time it was 6-month course was there. Nowadays, I believe there's only a 1-month course is there for internship. It is not so that there are less opportunities. Only thing, we did the issue, what is, when we came across, and whenever I talk to your professor also, I always say that those who are interested doing their career in biomedical, let them come to our place. But we cannot understand in a hospital, like we cannot cater 10 students at one time. So we always believe that we are taking 8 to 10 for different companies, colleges, because we cannot just say we are taking only from one college. We try to give training to all the students from all the colleges. But my idea is very clear that if someone is really interested to do his or her career in biomedical, you can contact me at any time. You will get internship definitely in Jupiter. That is my assurance. But if someone is just saying that for 1 month I have to do, because then I have to go to abroad and for that I have to spend time, then there is wastage of time for everyone. Like today also, as a passion I come here. It is not financial bonding at all. So I always believe that if someone is really interested to make career in biomedical, there is nothing impossible. As I told you, I also started career in biomedical only, and I used to travel almost 30 days, 28 days in a month. Okay, entire Maharashtra I covered through ST bus. All these things, if you are ready to do, biomedical is not easy. You have to put efforts, But if you put efforts, one thing I will tell you that now someone has asked me, is there a good scope of biomedical in India? Yes, Abhilasha, yes, it is there. Now I am talking to you. I started my career as biomedical, and nowadays from biomedical, only thing you should have a tendency to learn. Okay, like you also, I also learn only Kanpur when I was pass out. I will tell you my story also. There is a lot of scope of biomedical in India. Only thing you should, you cannot say that you will get starting salary of 50,000. It is not possible in biomedical in India. But if you sustain yourself, yes, there is a good scope of that. What can be the alternative for internship as the institute has online teaching mode now? Okay, so as an internship, as I told you, as a college, I don't know whether it's possible, but every time I say that students, if they can able to do that, or if there is a course where two or three old PCs has given to them, and if they can able to interconnect that, if there is software available or Windows, if they can able to load that Windows on that system, that also give them a lot of confidence when they will come on field. Please understand that today a lot of things are driven, or artificial intelligence are going to come in the next few years. So there is a lot of things which will be related to IT, means software related. So if they are confident enough to install any software, it will be easy for them to make sure that they are confident when they will come in the I can say in a hospital or any other hospital industry. It is possible. Do we have any certification? Geeta madam, there is not certification as such. As I said, it is a dedication only. If someone is wants to do it, they will able to learn it very fast. Only thing, as I told you, in biomedical currently the starting salary in most of the hospitals or industry will be around 20k or so. So are we ready for that? That is the first thing. And if you just able to put 2 or 3 years sincerely into biomedical field, you will learn everything what I discuss. Now this maintenance, as I told you, now I am doing lot of projects which are greenfield project, brownfield projects. But I am also from biomedical field. I was not knowing what is electrical. But when I enter into project, then I understood that I have to do. There is no other option. I have to learn. Similarly, networking. I may not be Microsoft certified networking guy, but I know what is required for biomedical field. What is necessary for the transferring image from DICOM from one place to another. These are the small things biomedical engineer has to learn from themselves. And if they learn it, management will understand the importance of biomedical engineer, and there is a lot of opportunities for them.
Yeah, what I mean to ask is, there are certification, even the Java certification or any software certification or any networking certification does not allow them, or they will not equip with them with the full knowledge. But as a starting, like any such certification is there in biomedical also? I just wanted to ask that one.
No, there is so no certification. They have to like on-job training.
Okay, that's all. Okay.
That's all.
Okay.
Because I'm sure now also all my colleagues who are in my, they might be still on RS Kanpur.
Maybe, yeah, Kanpur is same.
Yeah, Kanpur. So that is a Bible for biomedical. Yeah. That I also learn, my seniors also learn. So we are way behind in all these things. Our curriculum is not up to the level what it should be.
Yeah.
But whenever they will come on field, just matter of, I'm telling you, if they are sincere enough, in 2-3 months, they will understand everything. Now, after maybe experience of 24 years, can I say that I've done so many CT scan MRI installation? But I cannot say I am the master in everything. It's not practically possible. Earlier, I used to feel that CT scan and MRI, like high cost equipments, are very, very important. And you should have, if you are working on that machines, means you are having a great exposure in biomedical. Is it not? It is not true in a hospital setup. If you say ABG machine, which is used in pathology, which is very, very critical, because if your diet machine is down, you cannot give results to the ICU. They will not know the biochemistry or that patient, ABG patient. So equipments are, now someone has asked me, can I work in nuclear medicine department with the degree of biomedical? But nuclear medicine, what sense, Mr. As a technician, as a RSO, how do you want to do that? Abhilasha? Yeah, we can work in any department, but you need to define what you want to do. You want to do technician job, RSO job. Because we cannot, with a degree of biomedical, you cannot become the consultant of nuclear medicine. But yes, you can handle the machine, you can become application specialist. Application for all the girls who are there, they are having very good opportunities in application of ultrasound, mammography, nuclear medicine. There are a lot of opportunities are there.
Yeah, somebody is asking, what is your journey from engineer to CTO?
Anyone else?
Yeah, in the WhatsApp group, you cannot see that.
Okay, so I will tell you. I started my career in 1997, I passed out, and the first thing which I did was that I was a sales and service engineer for a company called as Elsyn. And I did the first MRI installation in Jupiter Scan Center, Thane. That was the smallest site in the world. This is Israel-based company. That was a 256 square feet area where we install MRI. Now, for you, you might have seen most of the times a question which always come, what is helium quench? Okay, or magnet quench, not helium quench, magnet quench. Now that magnet quench in my life, I have seen many times. Okay, and I realized, I've experienced that. So for 8 years, so after that I was there in L&T their R&D department for their ultrasound system, and then I joined G. Now I will tell you, and you will not believe on that. When I joined G, till that time I was also aware about the CT scanner, which is old technology of CT scan, and my first call was there at Nanded, and that call was there during Ganpati festival. Okay, so from Pune, I went to Devgiri Express to Nanded. I'm giving you this why I'm saying that. You will understand what are the difficulties was there and how I enter into biomedical and why I'm there in biomedical from 36 years. So I reached to that place and I called up that doctor. Sir, when you can it possible for you to send vehicle for me? I don't know because I can't able to find out anything vehicle outside. So he, the doctor that time mobile was not there, so it was PCO was there. So he told me one vehicle will come to you and they will take you up to Dr. Lane in Nanded. So I was so happy that after doing biomedical engineering first year only, someone is coming and picking me up. That is unbelievable experience for me. I waited for a long time, then that time pager was there. I was not understanding what to do, nothing has come. So again, I called up from PCO and I asked doctor, Saab, gaadi nahi aaya, kya karo? So he told me, just wait for some time, your vehicle is coming. And I was surprised, I saw vehicle, but which vehicle would be that? That vehicle was police van. So first time in my life with my tool bag and laptop, I enter into police van. I asked him where to go. So he said there is a curfew in a city and you are going to that place where a CT scan is down and there are some riots has happened between two communities and there are 40 people who were there who were supposed to undergo their CT scan. And believe me, when I entered there, I was not knowing anything about CT. As I told you, on job training, till that time I also learned about Kanpur, never seen any CT scan. And while entering into that room, I've seen that there are people who were there, they were standing, they were waiting me rigorously, and they were, some of them have said that, sir, saab, chalu hoga kya machine? For me also, it was a difficult question because I was also not knowing what is CT scan that moment and how I'm going to handle that. So I asked my boss that time, and he told me that Nilesh, now it is you have to make sure what is the issue. I cannot tell you on phone because there is no mobile also that time. So he told me you will have to do something and make sure that that machine is up. And I realized that if I would not able to solve that issue, it would have been 34 people who were injured. I would have been 35th person there. Because two communities, I am talking about this in 1999. And luckily, whatever I can say, or maybe this is destiny, I understood that that problem, and I could able to solve that problem. And that machine became up. And after that, back to back, 34 scans were done nonstop. And one of the patient, while going, touched my face, feet, and to say, "Sir, aap Bhagwan jaise ho." And that is a shocking for me also, that someone is saying that for biomedical engineer, "Aap Bhagwan jaise ho." I am not a doctor. I was wondering why he's saying that. But then I realized that if I would have not there, I would have not solved his issue. He would have struggled. He would have lost his near one. And then I thought that, yes, if I want to remain in this field, I have to remain in biomedical only. And then there are a lot of opportunities were there in US also, but I was there for some 7-8 months, came back to India. And again, when Dr. Ajay Thakkar, who is the owner of Jupiter, he told me that, because when I started my MRI, you were there. So now I'm going to start my hospital in Thane. Are you interested doing that? And it is pride moment for entire biomedical fraternity across India. I am the first person or the only person in industry as a biomedical engineer who is a founder member of any of the project, healthcare project across India. You will never come across any biomedical engineer who has joined there as a biomedical, as a first person of any project, because biomedical engineer always comes at a later stage. But I got that opportunity. That time I was not knowing what is meaning of project, believe me. I was not just knowing about the CT scan, MRI, ultrasound, radiology equipment, but I was not knowing what is meaning of project. And when I enter into project, I understood that there are a lot of things to learn. As a biomedical engineer, there is something lagging. I don't know anything. What is meaning of earthing? I don't know. Electrical supply, I don't know. So I said to myself that if I want to remain into this field, I have to learn something extraordinary. So why not electrical? Why not projects? And I started learning that from 2005. Till 2004, I was just as a biomedical engineer. And 2005, when I entered into projects, I started learning each and everything. Then as a biomedical engineer, if you do not have ego, then you can do a lot of things. I will tell you one story. There was a CT scan machine and there was one PCB. Ek nikalna tha. Normally, for to remove that PCB on online machine, when power is on, it was a very difficult job. So I was struggling at one location called as Sangamner. And that time, one of our office boy came there, and he asked me, he saw me, and he understood that there is something wrong, and I'm stuck up something. So he asked me, "Sir, kya hua?" So I just told him that I'm not able to enter into that, how to put the screwdriver inside and remove that PCB. I don't understand that. And this is live machine. What to do? I am not understanding. So he told me that, "Sir, give me some time." He went to bicycle shop, and you know that this is called a spana. Now we get a spanner. That fellow told me, "Sir, this is a pungli pana that you can use it and you can able to do this activity." Believe me, that small gadget, what he has given me. Now there is no ego. If you are having ego, you will not listen to that person. This is just the office boy. I said, "Okay, you do it. I will help you out in doing this." And then he told me how to do that, and I could able to solve that. And after that, this has become a gadget across India. Everyone started using this. So if you do not have ego in biomedical, you can move fast. If you are having queries, ask the queries to your seniors and move ahead. And after doing all these things, once I do the first Thane project, then I understood, yes, it is possible. You can do that. Now, once it is project, then how to handle the services. Then I enter into HVAC, electrical, MEP, plumbing, and then by Pune project, which I've done, that has become the only project across India, which is energy efficient project, which is certified by Indo-Swiss BIP agency. So all these things are possible. And now how I become CTO? with all this experience, because very unique thing is there that I can able to correlate between biomedical maintenance IT, and which gave me the idea or maybe opportunity to tackle all these technical issues. And finally, I could enter into CTO, become a CTO, and now I'm handling all our 3 hospitals and 10 departments along with the project. So when I'm saying 3 departments, which Thane is having biomedical maintenance IT for all 3 hospitals, Indore also. And with the experience now sitting at Mumbai also, recently, if you know that I did this BKC COVID hospital also. So all these are experience. When everyone was talking about COVID, I said, this is time where I have to put my efforts. And I enter into 26 March 2020, when no one was aware about what is isolation, what is quarantine. That time I enter into field in Seven Hill Hospital, then BKC with bare 3-ply mask. Only thing I was sure that whenever I am there on site, I don't have to be, drink water also and no food also. So for 8 to 10 hours continuously non-stop, no water, no food. This I have done for almost for 2 months, and we could able to achieve like projects like BKC, Thane, where we have done more than 10,000 in BKC, more than 5,000 in Thane. So many patients were cured, and that is given satisfactory as a biomedical engineer, that you can do anything that is satisfactory, because that is something much more than your commercial thing. And that is why I come as a passion. I always believe that biomedical engineer can do a lot of things. Only thing, they should have passion. If they are not clear whether they want to make career in India or they want to go abroad, then a lot of times they will spend in discussing among themselves what to do next. But there are opportunities are there. So please make sure that there are opportunities. You are already there. You have spent 3 to 4 years into this field, and you are having, and now artificial intelligence is coming. So there is opportunities are going to come in IT or in biomedical.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for your inspiring story. Yeah. Yes, Neeti.
Because tomorrow,
yes, sir.
Tomorrow, for all the biomedical engineers across Bombay, I'm going to give this story only for them. So this is today I have given for this, for those who are going to become biomedical engineer very soon. But tomorrow I'm going to give it to all biomedical engineers who are working across Bombay, all hospitals. So that event is there in Powai. So great. I am telling you one thing for all the students who are listening to that. If you come across any query, you can call me at any time, because biomedical engineer should be ready for 24/7. It's tough, but it is doable.
Today, my words are not enough to express my gratitude. Thank you so much, sir, for taking out your precious time and conducting this session, giving us such great insights of medical device safety. I am sure every participant now has knowledge of equipment maintenance and disinfection, safety checks before installation, dedicated earthing, quality assurance and proactive checks, UPSC battery rack, calibration, USG machine, ELCB testing, etc. I would also like to add, VIT has MOU with Jupiter Hospital, and Mr. Nilesh Shinde, sir, is instrumental in getting it. We are thankful that he has agreed to conduct this session honorarily, that is without any financial involvement. We are thankful to Mr. Nilesh, sir, for allowing our students to undertake internships and also recruited some of our students. I request all the participants to please switch on your cameras for a quick photograph.
So Neeti, shall I ask one question?
Now, yes, sir.
Last 2 years, you are everyone on online. How difficult it is?
It is difficult, sir, to cope up with academics, as we have not yet experienced hands-on practicals yet. So everything is online. Even the practicals are online.
Okay.
Please switch on the cameras. Participants, please switch on the cameras.
is the screenshot taken? Shall I move ahead?
Yes, Neeti, you can move ahead.
Okay. I would like to request Professor Geeta ma'am to add few words.
Hello, sir. I'm audible, right?
Yes, yes, madam.
Thank you, sir. When you started the lecture, I was feeling I am a basic electrical engineer. I'm electrical engineer, basically. I have done my electrical engineering in 1991. And I was looking at the earthing. I was feeling, hey, sir is explaining all the earthing features. So he's starting from earthing and going, then directly switching into data safeguarding. And then equipments from syringe pump to MRI machine. And then placing of the oxygen to minute details like oxygen cylinder, where to keep the oxygen cylinder, he was explaining. So looking at it, that shows that the experience and hands-on he has done in his 24 years of service. And after hearing his story about the CT scan repair, I'm sure that he has done a lot of things hands-on. And it is obvious from the presentation, and all the participants might have got a lot of experience. Actually, they might have seen the things, and you have shown enough videos, and they are the actual videos taken from the hospital in which you are working. It was very obvious that you are doing, and that videos you have taken, and you have taken from safety to calibration also. I have seen that. So I'm really impressed. I am really feeling that I have come to teaching instead of going into industry. I should have gone. I'm feeling that way. The presentation was obvious result of the extensive experience and personal handling of all these cases. And VIT Biomedical Engineering Department is really thankful to Nilesh sir for giving this session on medical device safety. And actually, when we invited him for medical device safety, that also I am remembering, he called. He called up Suvarna ma'am. Later, I called him up, and sir was asking, it is based, the course is on medical regulation and manufacturing, and I am not having any experience in that field. This, you are the correct person for this medical safety, sir. No other person can give this much of exposure to the medical safety and installation, and the students and the participants might have got an experience of how to install things in the hospital. So that is basic thing which a biomedical engineer should know. Thank you, sir, for coming and giving this session to us. I'm sure the participants are gained a lot from this excellent presentation. Now, on behalf of Vidyalankar, BMSA and BMESI, I would like to thanks, sir, for giving this excellent presentation, and thank you, sir, and we are waiting for the next session. So next session means when next you will come and then give us the insight to the details.
No, I am ready to come to your place. I'm not worried about Corona. So I travel a lot.
But our students are not there, no, sir. We are also going to college, but students are not coming.
But so if any one of you students are interested in projects, okay, currently I'm doing some project in our Thane hospital.
Okay.
So if they are willing, they will get the insight what is happening in project.
Let them
get the idea. So because this small thing, if they learn before they go into industry, that will give enough experience for them and courage for them that they can able to sustain in this biomedical field. Because the question dilemma is there. Biomedical karnavi, if you someone asks me, it is, I will tell you very clearly, it is my destiny. I am into biomedical. I was supposed to go to medical. I did not know, so I landed up in biomedical. I was not knowing when I joined engineering, I was not knowing what is meaning of biomedical engineering, but just because it was medical, what was there, I entered into that. But this I am talking 92-93, but now I feel that I came to right place. And when this corona entered, I feel that yes, as a biomedical engineer, may not be I'm consultant, but I'm doing a lot of things for the mankind. Because currently I'm doing vaccination throughout entire Thane district. I've done almost more than 1 lakh vaccination camps. This is nothing to do with biomedical, but the passion for the patient or maybe beneficiary, which is driving me.
Thank you, sir. Great, sir,
it's possible for all the students who are there, who are listening to me. Biomedical engineer can do miracle. Please, please listen to that. Don't go into that. I understand your IT colleague will get more salary at initial stage, but at this stage, now during Corona, ask your IT colleagues, who is happy person? Is a biomedical engineer who is a happy person? Who is doing lot of things for patient? They are getting satisfaction and their job is also secure.
Yes, sir.
Believe me on this. Job is also secure. This is the only field where job is secure. Other people are struggling because now I know everything. All other fields, they are struggling, like a hospital industry, hotel industry is dying like anything. So biomedical, we should be proud of that, that you are into right field. So don't, please don't change it just for the sake of some financial advantages.
Yes, true, sir. Really, it is a noble job. Okay, Nidhi, back to you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir, for your kind words. We have our next session tomorrow, that is on Saturday, 25th September, from 2 p.m. onwards, on Regulatory Framework for Medical Devices, a Global Perspective. Hoping to see you all there. Please fill up the feedback form. The link is posted in the chat box. Thank you, all the faculty members.
One minute. Tomorrow's guest also is very experienced. And he is into the medical device regulations, like how to get approvals of FDA. You might have heard about FDA. FDA approval is required whenever you are making a medical device. So how to get the approvals of FDA. He is having a lot of experience in this field, and he is a consultant in getting approvals for all these equipments and for industries also. So anyone is interested to start up, for them also, he will be giving a lot of insight. And those lectures, if you are attending, you can always take that reference for contacting them. I had attended this lecture of yours at this place. Karke, you can start the conversation always. So it will be always helpful when you are taking. So that's all from my side. That's all.
Thank you, ma'am, and all the faculty members and participants for being a part of this event today. Hoping to see you soon. Stay home, stay safe. Have a great evening.
Thank you. Thank you, Neeti.
Welcome, ma'am.